now that I'm familiar with the alphabet because I have some letters. And so I appreciate the invitation to be here before your group, your members, and your guests tonight. I would like to point out that we do have a good deal of information to provide about the thoughts, words, and deeds of DD Palmer. I've looked at this for quite a number of years. Probably going to provide more information than you really want tonight. I will have a short break for you halfway through. We'll look at the clock and probably try to keep it down to about 5 minutes or so to make sure that we get through on time. I want to acknowledge the fact that I'm here before you tonight by acknowledging my brother, who all of you know, Myron Brown, who had so much to do with encouraging me to be a part of the profession. Otherwise, I wouldn't be speaking here before you tonight. And I can remember a time when I was a lost college student a lot of years ago, and he brought me to meet some of his friends and learn a little something about chiropractic as a potential way of getting into a career. I was a biology major in college, wanting to make sure I was in college and not in Vietnam. And he helped me find a purpose, and so did these people as well. Although I must point out that he was a little younger back then. And, well, I guess my time thing got off a little bit. And I was very impressionable. I was younger yet. He was going for the well-dressed look. You'll see how he's got the bow tie on, very straight there. I was going for the cute look. And you all can decide which one of us was successful. Let's get back to DD Palmer. First thing to understand a little something about this man, we might want to look at all of the things that he was during his life, all of these vocations. He was a teacher. He taught school, and we'll go back to talk about that. He spent time in jail as a convict. He was a grocer, very successful grocery operation. He was a cooper. He worked in a factory making barrels at one point in time. By religion, he was a spiritualist, which had a lot to do with why you're doing what you're doing today. He was also a magnetic healer, as I'm sure you're aware. He was an inventor, a very inventive individual. He took a different path than most people would take. He was an extraordinarily successful beekeeper, one of the top in his field. He sold fish in a wheelbarrow as a fish peddler. Yes, he was also a farmer. He was a psychic, which many people are not aware of. And of course, yes, he was a chiropractor. And if he were here speaking to you today, he would say, well, wait a minute, those were just my jobs. I was also a scientist. I was also a philosopher. And so that's the kind of personality we're going to talk to you about tonight. Let me summarize in his words, though. He said, my environments over which I have no control have forced me into chiropractic. I have done the best I could. Angels could do no better. I will, however, leave the world better for my having lived in it, and I think we all agree that he did. I have always made it a rule to keep my eyes and ears open, never afraid to gather information from nature, wash women, or angels. And I think as you learn more about his personality, you're going to find out that that was true. It's important when we talk about D.D. Palmer, who is often looked at out of context, that we build context. So as I go through this information with you tonight, you're going to find me continuously relating back to what is contextual. And so we're kind of like looking at objects in a wax museum. You notice when you've been in wax museums, they always try to build the figure in context with their time period. That's what I'll be endeavoring to do with you. So let's go back to the 1860s when this was beginning, and history books at that time were saying that no other invention has exercised more impact on humanity than this particular invention. Got any guesses what it was? Oh, it's okay to speak up. This can be conversational tonight if you're of a mind.
Typewriter?
It wasn't the typewriter. It was Samuel Morse's telegraph. And it was the first time we had instant messaging, wasn't it? And let's look at an example of why this was such a big deal. First of all, you've all heard about the famous Battle of New Orleans. Remember that in the War of 1812? It was fought on January 8th, 1812. What was unique about that battle besides being the bloodiest war, or the bloodiest battle in the war? Anybody know? Well, the Treaty of Ghent ending the war had been signed 2 weeks before the battle. Kind of ironic when communication fails us. So in this context of the 1830s, they were starting to experiment electrically with creating a telegraph in both Europe and the United States. And there was one great obstacle between the two. Even though we were starting to get the dits and so on put together, we had this huge body of water between the two areas. And so we know that in 1845, this concept of laying a cable across the floor of the ocean came about. It's also the same time that DD Palmer was given birth. So all of this conversation puts you in context for where this came about. And so we know that it took about a decade after 1845 to get that first cable laid and functioning. And we also know that DD Palmer was born on the frontier, and this is what it looked like just outside of Toronto back in the 1840s. And his parents were Thomas and Catherine Palmer. They were out there in what was called Canada West back in those days. It was the frontier. It wasn't a great city like we know today. And as a side note, the transatlantic cable broke almost immediately after it was put into service, and it took them years to get it back into service again. And so let's look at you. This is the Garden State and how it appeared in 1845 at the birth of D.D. Palmer. And let's look at a little bit more. About a mile from here was this place, Menlo Park, the first, you've all heard about Edison's Menlo Park Laboratory. That's what it looked like in the 1870s, around the same time period that we're going to come back to in D.D. Palmer's life. So building some context, here's the birth of D.D. Palmer in 1845 in Canada. 1861, he's a young man. The Civil War breaks out in the United States. 1880s, Edison invents the light bulb. The Wright brothers ignited the 20th century in 1903, and then in 1913, Henry Ford's Model T is now built in mass on the assembly line. And 1913, that same year, is the end of D.D. Palmer's life. So that gives you a quick glance at his lifeline. Put it in historical context, and we'll show you many illustrations of how that gets lost during the life of D.D. Palmer. Here's his family. Try to give you pictures because I've got so much data to give you that hopefully those who aren't interested in a lot of words can get something out of the photos. He had three sisters, and his father and his mother are in the picture there. D.D., of course, in the middle, and his brothers. And we'll talk more about the family. He can trace his lineage all the way back to the Pilgrims in Massachusetts. And we know that, I'm not sure how you do this, his great, here's D.D., so his grandfather, great, and this guy, William Palmer, served under Miles Standish. By the way, all of my information has references. If anybody wants reference to anything I give you tonight, send me an email. My email address is on the screen later again, and I'll supply reference to anything you'd like to see. And so we know that the Palmer family was of both Scotch and Irish as well as German descent. And we know that they go right back to the earliest part of the founding of this country. We also know that somewhere in the early part of the experience, the Palmer family split off and ended up in Canada. And so this piece of history shows that in 1623, when all of the Pilgrims each got 2 acres of land for their individual families, one acre for each family, D.D. Palmer's great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather got 2 acres, but he was out there just outside the fort and a little ways off into the country to get that extra doubling of his land. D.D. Palmer grew up as a frontier person. And for from BJ's work, we read in Fight to Climb how residents of Port Curry, which was his hometown, not his birthplace, is that he was a keen youth. He was a husky young boy, very inquisitive, very active, and grew up with a great interest in anatomy. And so we find this thing about health and the structure of the body to be a fascination with him, even as a young child. All that knew him described him as hardy, merry, and he had an exceptional mind. And you'll see this throughout from all the historians who looked at his lifeline. We know that D.D., born in 1845, tutored with what they called a brutish taskmaster, who was the tutor to both D.D. and his brother T.J., who was 2 years younger, and that they studied Latin and Greek, they studied the sciences, they studied philosophy in a way that students of that age don't get today. We know that when D.D. was 11 years old in 1856, the family emigrated because the business of the family failed. And so they emigrated from Canada down to the United States for better economic opportunity. Funny thing happened on the way to the United States. You know what happened? Oh, they forgot to bring some of the kids.
No.
D.D. at age 11 and his younger brother at age 9 were left behind in Canada. And D.D. was working in that factory making barrels at the time to help support the family. And they were told that when things get a little better, come join the family in Iowa. Now, have any of you ever had 9 and 11-year-old kids in your family? Can you imagine putting your head in that context and leaving them behind on the frontier to fend for them? You tried it?
But my wife would never go.
She wouldn't go for it. She was probably right again. And so, try to give you, here's one of the textbooks that's documented as having been used in their tutoring. This was Parker's First Lessons in Natural Philosophy, one of the mid-1800s standards. Here's where the family went. They went to the booming coal town of Wachier, Iowa. And this is what it looked like at the time period. There was a good economy there, and D.D.'s father could find work. He was actually a postmaster in the town. And then as the worm turned back up in Canada, the Civil War in the United States began, and an opposite situation happened. Do you know how once in a while we have young men go to Canada to avoid the draft or to avoid military service? That's what happened in 1865. And Americans in Canada flooded the job market, and all of a sudden D.D. and T.J. couldn't make a living anymore, so they left Canada to come down to the United States. And so in 1865, they walked 18 miles to Lake Ontario from that northeast part of Toronto. And they found their way, they worked their way gradually across the Great Lake, and they got to Buffalo, New York. Then they migrated over to Detroit. They got a ride with a troop carrier, a train of U.S. soldiers over from Detroit to Chicago. And then from Chicago, they were getting pretty close to Iowa and the Midwest. And so it took them 2.5 months with something like $6 in their pockets to make the trip from Canada to Iowa. There's your graphic to show you where they were. Of course, here's where D.D. was born on the Canadian side, came over to Buffalo, New York, then Detroit, Chicago, and then eventually ending up in Iowa. Physically, D.D. was short. He had been known to be wearing that particular Western sombrero. If you ever go to visit the archives at Palmer College, you can see that sombrero still in a glass case in BJ's house. He was known to have been a very combative person when it came to arguing his belief systems. He was kind of like Rush Limbaugh, only he was right. So, just kidding. Anyway, we also know from BJ's writing that he had a strong ethical system. And when he came to the United States, even though he was a Canadian, he would have been eligible to be conscripted into the Army. But it was legal in those days to pay someone else to serve your time. And BJ documents that he paid $500 in order to not have to serve in the military. The reason wasn't that he was afraid. The reason given was that he just felt it was wrong to kill another person. D.D. Palmer arrived on the Mississippi River in the area of what's now the Quad Cities, Davenport, Rock Island, Moline, and Bettendorf, and he began to teach in school, as did his brother T.J. They were in the public school system when it was only 30 years old, and he taught on both the Iowa and the Illinois sides of the Mississippi River in what were one-room type schoolhouses. They looked a lot like this. We've traced it down to a couple of the locations. We didn't get, this building is typical of this, the type of structure he taught in. It's not one that we can document he actually taught in, just one we could get a good photo of those that still remain standing today. But we were able to document that he taught in this particular building when he moved into the town of Letts, Iowa. And this was way above. It was the cutting edge of education in its day. It actually had heat, and it was a solid two-story structure. No longer exists, but we were able to document in museums and other archives. From his handwritten journal, we found this statement. He said, "Little seeds are like little deeds. They grow to flowers and weeds." And he was a very philosophic person. You'll see that throughout the presentation about him. And as a school teacher, I just wanted to make a point here, if this will work. Maybe it will.
Basically, my focus is on creative, getting more people interested in, you know, taking these advanced classes. Having people for more advanced classes, and really seeing people here today, we can move on.
So by today's standards, that would be a very strict teacher, would it not?
Yeah.
I mean, nowadays, students are down there like this, and you wonder what they're looking at in their laps, right? But by those standards, let's look at what was going on in D.D. Palmer's diary, to where he wrote his notes about how to be a good teacher. When you whip the students, give time between strokes. And don't let them leave while they're still sulky. Let them think about what they've been doing. This is a punishment issue. And now watch this. As one of the last resorts for subduing a pupil, tie the thumbs together and suspend. Have any of you had that happen? So you get the idea that he was serious as an educator, but in the context of that time. And you may think that sounds awfully mean. But let's look at, here's the Iowa State Rules and Regulations from 1862, about 3 years before he started teaching in the system. And it says they may inflict punishment by detaining a pupil and whipping with a switch or a strap, but they couldn't do it with something that was inflexible. And they also said, this one I thought was interesting, they can't pull their hair or their ears or put them in ridiculous postures. And I was wondering, did D.D. violate the rules by suspending them by their thumbs if he couldn't put them in a ridiculous posture? What do you think? I think it's ridiculous. But again, think of the context of where they were and who they were. Here's BJ speaking about himself and his siblings. And he said, all three of us got beatings with straps until we carried welts, for which father spent night in jail. And so he said, our younger sister got an abscess and that he had a fractured vertebra, BJ, and that's documented. And that none of this, watch the last sentence, none of this was because he was particularly cruel or inhuman. It's the context of the times. Today you can't look angry at a student when you're teaching. different times. And that's what DD's family looked like. There's his BJ stepmother, Villa, his sister, May, his younger sister, Jessie. And BJ was the youngest of three children.
Excuse me, was this the same gentleman that did not want to go to war for fear of hurting people?
Exactly.
Killing people.
Killing is different than suspending by your thumb. Yes, it's a good observation, though. I mean, you're going to see lots of contrast in who this person was. He was very gentle and at times seemed tyrannical. Good point. My first project when I decided to get into scholarly work on the history of our profession was to find the farm where D.D. Palmer lived before he became a magnetic healer, before he became a spiritualist, to see what he was doing before he got into all this stuff that you're about. And so we found out that he had a small farm on the Illinois side of the river, just outside of a town called New Boston, Illinois. So a friend of mine, Gene Drazel, and I, both chiropractors in eastern Iowa at the time, took on a project and we decided to locate the farm, find out where he was and see if we could find artifacts. Maybe we find a treasure chest that D.D. left behind or something. And so the first thing we did was we went to the author of the family authorized biography of D.D. Palmer. Vern Gilo was a good friend of my good friend Bud Crowder. Bud Crowder was the longtime vice president of Palmer College. He worked for BJ for about 10 years, and he was my chiropractor. I was his chiropractor back in Iowa. And so he arranged this dinner meeting at a Chinese restaurant with Vern Gilo so we could pick his brain on what all he had to do to learn about the life of D.D. Palmer in order to write that book. It was very enlightening and sent us on our quest to find Sweet Home. It took us about a year. He actually put an X on the mark, or an X mark, on the map to show us where it was. Of course, we found out the X was several miles off, but nevertheless, he helped us, got us to the right general place. A lot of trips to museums, a lot of trips to county courthouses, and eventually we were able to identify it on plot maps and cross-reference to show that the deed for D.D. Palmer was this 10-acre slot. And this is flat land at the bottom, which was Mississippi floodplain. And up here, you can't really see much of a hill, but there's quite a little bluff up there in the trees. His 10 acres was 5 acres down here and 5 acres up on the hill. He called it Sweet Home. Now from the top of the hill, you can get an idea of the Mississippi River off there in the distance, and we're quite a ways up shooting the picture between the trees. It doesn't really give you much appreciation because of our photography quality at the time, but I can tell you at that time, about 15 years ago, I was winded after walking up the hill. So it was steep. And there's a picture of myself and my son leaning against one of the trees that we were able to document was actually planted by D.D. He was a meticulous record keeper, and in his handwritten journals, he had a grid map for every non-indigenous tree he planted on the hillside with their names and what they were, so we could actually look at the trees that were still there, and you can see some of them had lost their bark, but there were a lot of these thorny locust trees. And if you look real close at this picture, you see those thorns? Some of those thorns are 4 to 6 inches long, and those thorny locusts were a reason why he chose this particular piece of land, because he wanted to raise honey and he wanted to raise raspberries there. And so the locust honey was one of the things that happened at that particular site. Here, after we identified the land, we contacted its current owners and got permission to mark the site. So I made a granite marker, and there's my friend Gene digging a hole. We brought 300 pounds of concrete to put the granite in, so it's about 500 pounds altogether. The idea was we didn't want somebody picking it up and running away with it. And so you can see that we now identified the site of Sweet Home, the 1870s apiary nursery, came in to address the first year students. So you get all the first year students together and hold an assembly and talk about his memoirs and his family experience. I remember him talking about the time when grandfather went to New York, and he took a carload, a railroad carload of honey with him. And when he came back, he was bragging to family and friends about the tumor growing right here on his left breast. And then he would pull out this big roll of dollars that were his tumor. But he was extraordinarily successful. DD Palmer was one of the biggest producers of honey in the entire United States. And here's the American Bee Journal, and we find out that DD Palmer had regular entries that he would send in as a correspondent, even though he was a farmer, to the journal, and he was a regular participant. This came up only in the most recent time period. I didn't know it existed when we were doing our earlier studies, but a book has recently been published about this. And so we know that he brought $3,000 profit. Now in the 1870s, $3,000 was a lot of money. Today it maybe doesn't go near as far. And so there's another copy of that time period. There's the Beekeeper Journal. And he says honey is retailing in New York at 25 to 30 cents a pound at that time period. We know that about 7 miles away from DD's home was the town of New Boston, and a couple more miles further in the opposite direction, but less than 10 miles from his home, was this place called Verdurette. And here's the site of Sweet Home. Here's the Mississippi River. Here's that place, Verdurette, which was a hotbed of spiritualism. And that had an effect on DD. His friends and neighbors were amongst the leaders of the spiritualist movement in the United States. This was the home of a man named Drury. And Drury was the largest landowner in the United States at that time period. This home, built in the mid-1800s, was extraordinary. But this is where DD would walk to in order to attend meetings and to learn about spiritualism. Now, spiritualism, it may sound hokey as all get out. I remember when I first learned about chiropractic and magnetic healing from my brother, and I said, it's a bunch of hooey, you know? And it still sounds like a bunch of hooey, doesn't it? I gotta tell you, spiritualism was actually common and almost mainstream in the 1800s. Here you can see some of the crown heads of Europe were active in the spiritualist movement. There's Queen Victoria, who had seances to try to contact Prince Albert, Empress Eugenie of France, many famous people. Here in the White House, we had examples of spiritualism going on. We know that Willie was the son of the president and his wife, and he died while they were living in the White House. And we know that they held seances to try to communicate with Willie. Mary Todd was known to have gone over the deep end over that. And lots of famous people were into spiritualism. By religion, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the famous Sherlock Holmes author, was a spiritualist. And those who have studied spiritualism say it's not all as weird as it sounds. And this one PhD who wrote some books and lectures on the subject drew some interesting parallels, and she noticed that most of the people who were into spiritualism were also into some other things like abolition and women's suffrage. There seemed to be a high level of consciousness amongst this particular group of people. And so, well, she said that others wrote about the subject of how a lot of the people on the Underground Railway were spiritualist. It just seemed to somehow mesh real well with those individuals. Mary Todd is shown here where a particular fraudulent photograph was doctored to make it look like after the assassination, there's Abe Lincoln with his hands on her shoulders. And so you can see the hokey, the fraud, and you can see the serious-minded people who were really into this, and that's not new. We go back to the 1500s and Nostradamus, who predicted some things that came about, like Hiroshima and Hitler and Napoleon and the death of Princess Diana. These were all things that were able to get symbolically and almost literally out of the writings of Nostradamus. And then, of course, many popular TV shows that were going on and many movies that are mostly contemporary things, not just in the United States. When I presented this in Japan, I found some movies that were real popular and some popular culture over there that they also related to. The animated folks are into spiritualism as well. They don't call it spiritualism. They call it mediumship and some other things. But it's the same stuff. And even reality TV now has a popular medium. I just stumbled on that one last week. This is a college girl who does readings on the side. So it's not something as out there as you might think.
Can I interject you with one more question?
Of course, as many as you'd like.
Was there a defining moment that transformed him to start practicing spiritualism? I mean, prior you're saying that he was this definitely abusive man. What happened that switched him now to embrace spiritualism?
Chronologically, I don't have a concrete answer, but I believe that it goes along with the geography of where he lived when he was teaching school, and then he took that that land that he and his wife purchased in order to make more money, because school teachers got very little money. And so their idea was to get into the horticultural activity for more money, and all the people in the area were into this spiritualism. So we had a geographic as well as chronological connection. And I'll also show you where his wife, his first wife, had an influence on him in a moment. And so you'll find BJ, his son, talking about how he did not join any religion, but that the closest thing to a religion he had was spiritualism. Not for the seances, holding hands and selling ideas around the table for profit. And here's an actual advertisement that was found where his wife, Dr. Abba Lord Palmer, her name was Abba Lord, his first wife, was advertising in New Boston as a clairvoyant psychic reader. And so we know that she was a spiritualist at the same time when DD Palmer was a school teacher and a horticulturist. He was not only raising honey, but he was also raising nursery stock of a hybrid raspberry that he created himself. And he sold nursery stock all over the country. And of course, with all his meticulous record keeping, I got to see long lists of pages of people that he shipped his nursery stock to in faraway places like Florida, New Jersey, California, and all over the Midwest. And so we know that he was influenced by his first wife. We also know that marriage did not last very long, but apparently they did. They stayed together about a year or so. They had a baby, would have been a half-sister to BJ that died as an infant. And when we were up there at Sweet Home on the Hill, we found remnants of what would have been the grave of that infant child. And he also got involved in that side of spiritualism that took it seriously. He went around the country trying to bust the frauds, the people who were fraudulently having smoke and mirrors and trying to make this thing profitable. This another famous person who went around busting the fraud spiritualists was Harry Houdini, who was one of B.J. Palmer's cronies. And here inside one of D.D. Palmer's raspberry nursery catalogs, we see a statement about how D.D. Palmer was committed to revealing the frauds from spiritualism because he had a high regard for what this non-material side of life was all about, and he didn't like people bringing it down by what they were doing. So he had a conscience about the thing. Here back at Virtuette, I wanted to give you a sense of how different this looked from the rest of the prairie around that western Illinois, Mississippi River area. You can see the architecture didn't look like your typical farmhouse back in the 1800s. It was that Victorian type of thing gone wild. This fellow, William Drury, began in real estate and in a grocery business, became extraordinarily wealthy, largest landowner in the country. That house you just saw was a 24-room house, the first one in the Midwest to have hot and cold running water, steam, heat, and gas lights. And he had a wild animal preserve on that piece of ground you just saw, where there were buffalo, deer, elk, tigers, all kinds of unusual things were going on. This was not your everyday people. Here's what the fence was, all this wrought iron stuff that looked nothing like anything else I'd seen on the prairie. He had fountains on the property.
And that's still there?
Yes. We photographed this when we wanted to go find it. It took a while to track it down as well. And the progeny of Drury still own this property. And you can see statues on the fences. Just nothing like, even the barn had that kind of weird Gothic look to it. And there's some of the sculptures that were on the land. It's just all over the place. It was just plain spooky. They're trying to get that spooky feel to the place. Anyway, DD Palmer had this clairvoyant thing going on that BJ didn't like to talk about much. But he did. I was fascinated by this one. He talked about how one of the tricks that DD liked to play was he would go to the post office and say to the postmaster, "You've got a letter that was mailed to me from another town yesterday." Now, it was yesterday. He wasn't there to mail it. And he said, "Would you go and bring it to me?" He'd put the letter on his head, on his forehead, unopened, and he would go about reading everything in the letter. He would even criticize misspelled words and poor punctuations and things of that sort. Then he would hand it back to the postmaster and said, "Now read it." And the postmaster would be like flabbergasted, "You got it all right." So he was unusual. And that, of course, is what DD looked like at that particular time period. Not your average guy. Also, one of his cronies was a fellow by the name of Flint. And one of the things that DD wanted to do with BJ when he was a teenager, and you can see him dressed to the nines in that particular picture, was he wanted him to gain a sense of worth and a sense of ability. BJ talked about himself as being a fairly worthless young man up until this moment in time. And BJ said this is what turned him. This is what changed his life. And what happened was DD sent him on the road with this guy, Herbert Flint, who was a hypnotist who actually had a show. And they traveled all around the Midwest. And he was sent on the road to learn showmanship from Herbert Flint. Here's a picture of Herbert Flint, and here's a picture of, it's interesting when you read BJ's 1950 book, he repeatedly refers to Marina Flint as Marina, Herbert's wife, comma, daughter, comma, or concubine. And that's how he keeps referring to her, because he never figured out, even though he traveled with these people, which she was, wife, daughter, or concubine. But that was Marina, and that was some of the advertising from the show that they put on. And this was a textbook written about hypnotism in that contemporary time period. And in chapter one, it references the Herbert L. Flint method. And so this was not somebody who was just a guy who dabbled in hypnotism. He was a highly regarded showman of hypnotism. He was the kind who would go on stage, and there's Marina put in a trance, and she could be so rigid that they would hold her up, and that's Herbert, and that's one of his hypnotist friends. So this was somewhat real, somewhat showman. You tell me where one starts and the other leaves off. You'll see here a 200-pound rock on her torso, and somebody is called out of the audience to break the rock, and that did that as a regular part. And here she is suspended between two chairs. How many of you would volunteer to get hypnotized that way? BJ said that he was actually hypnotized and did that trick between the two chairs. I think you're all lucky that the guy from the audience didn't miss the rock.
I would think that would cause subluxations.
Probably, but they didn't know about it yet. So let's talk about DD's personality a little. He was a man who, once he became interested in anything at all, that was what he did. He gave his 100% focus to whatever that item was he was interested in there and now. Great resentment from his children about that fact, because he wasn't much of a dad. He was an omnivorous reader, according to historian August Dye, and especially about healthcare sciences, and there's evidence to document that that is true. So back to the timeline. We have 1865, during the Civil War. Now at age 20, D.D. and his brother at age 18 leave Canada to come down to Iowa and join the family. They didn't actually make it all the way to Wachir, which was 100 miles further west. They got to this Mississippi River area, and they became teachers there. And then in 1870, we're talking 5 years after their arrival, we find D.D. is now married to Dr. Abba Lord Palmer, the clairvoyant psychic reader, and they've now purchased Sweet Home on the Illinois side of the river. Their marriage ended within, 1873, so it was within 3 years that marriage ended. I learned as we were trying to track this down that when the marriage ended, Abba sold 5 acres, half the property, to someone else in the area on a deed, which is recorded in the county courthouse. And yet, later on, when D.D. sold his half, he sold all 10 acres. Interesting. So I was there going through these dusty things, and I asked an attorney who was looking up some stuff. I said to her, how could he sell 10 acres when she had sold 5 before? He didn't own 10. And she said, well, it's easy, because it was sold on a quit claim deed. He didn't have to own it, he just had to quit claiming it. And that's how it worked. This was BJ's mother. The year after the separation between D.D. and Abba Lord, he meets Luvinia Landers, who was a widow of a Civil War soldier from Louisiana. She was a Creole from what they called the upper crusts of society. She took her toddies in bed and things of that sort. Her family owned 900 slaves in Louisiana up until the time of the Great Emancipation. And then we find, just a few years later, they're 6 years into their marriage, they've stayed on the farm, and then this horrible winter happens in 1880 to 1881, and it turns out that all the bees died, their livelihood went down the toilet in a big hurry, and D.D. Palmer sells Sweet Home and moves to Wachir, 110 miles from where they were living, into Iowa, to be with the family who had left him when he was how old?
11.
11, and his brother was 9. This particular book and picture were from a Laura Ingalls Wilder story, where she was talking about that winter was the severest winter on record, and she wrote about the book, The Long Winter. They opened a grocery store in Wachir, and they called it Palmer's Cheap Cash Store. And it was not because they sold cheap junk, it was because the customer could get a cheap price because everything was cash, no credit. And so he was a strong believer. No matter what he was doing, he took his position, he verified it, and he lived by it.
The original dollar
store. And then in 1882, the next year, BJ is born in Wachir, Iowa. And that, of course, to Luvinia, who was the second wife. This was their store. I'm sorry, it's the only picture I've ever been able to find of that building close up. And that's where, of course, this was maybe 75 years later in disrepair. And there's an advertisement for the cheap cash store showing you a number of the products that you could buy in the store at the time that they were operating it. here's what the city looked like at that time period. It was a dirt street. You could see horses and wagons. And if you look real closely, you'll see this building right over here. That's the one that his store was. That was Fish Palmer's Cheap Cash Store. At that time period, and we don't know exactly when, but at that general time period, we know that D.D. Palmer, the spiritualist, began to do more spiritualistic things. And he became interested in magnetic healing. It just so happens that not far from Wachier, Iowa, was the town of Ottumwa, Iowa, where Paul Castor, the country's most successful magnetic healer, happened to have his hospital. And Paul Castor is pictured here. He was a disciple of Antoine Mesmer. Heard of Antoine Mesmer? Mesmerism, mesmerizing, oh, yes. Named after the hypnotist. Well, he was in the French courts of Europe and around Europe. Eventually became very successful and ignited the concept of hypnotism, but he called it animal magnetism. This guy Castor is pictured here with a whole bunch of crutches and canes were left behind by people who he had cured magnetically and no longer had need for their handicap supports. And here is a book that was written about mesmerism by Mesmer, and he called it animal magnetism. Here's a map showing you the area. Here's Davenport, the Mississippi River again, Lake Michigan over there. Here's Ottumwa, where Castor was. Here's Wachier, where the X is. From the two areas, it's a 40-minute car ride, but in those days, they had a railroad spur that ran between the two, so it was real easy for him to make the trip to Ottumwa. In about another week, there'll be a book released that I wrote the foreword to for Todd Waters, the fourth in a series of books that he's written on the life of D.D. Palmer. And this one is all about the spiritual side of D.D. Palmer. And he theorizes that because Paul Castor died in 1881, that maybe he didn't actually learn from Paul Castor, even though all the history of the profession says that he did, and B.J. says that he did. But he's saying, well, wait a minute, how did he learn from Paul Castor if he didn't become a magnetic healer till 1883 and Castor was already dead by that time? But we also know that his son took up the practice as well, C.S. Castor. So whether he learned it before Castor died or whether he learned it from his son, that's out there as conjecture right now. But we know that it was the Castor influence, and that goes right back to Mesmer. So we have 1884, D.D. is again teaching school, and we know that Lavinia died that year. She was a young woman, only 31 years old. So BJ's mother was, what, 3 when he died, or when she died? And so he didn't really know his mother well. And then we find the town of Burlington, Iowa, is the first place where D.D. Palmer practiced, but only for a few months. It was less than 6 months. And then he started to grow and he wanted to move to a bigger city, so he went up here to Davenport. And 1887, in the second year after he had started, or actually the first year after he'd started, he's practicing magnetic healing in Davenport, Iowa. And so we see some promotional piece from D.D. Palmer as a magnetic healer and some testimonial from a publisher. There's the building where he has magnetic healing practice. Look at this photo of D.D. Palmer with his hair down. You see how low his hair comes? He was a snappy dresser too. See the little chain hanging there? Here's the memoirs of grandson Dave Palmer talking about his grandfather, D.D. He said, as I was being held, sitting on my, let me back that up if I may. Well, anyway, sitting on his grandfather's knees, he said he was very impressed by D.D. Palmer's large, warm hands. This was a big man, not tall, but a big, strong man. And he said, well, maybe that's because he had been a magnetic healer. That's what he wrote in his memoirs. And here's a description of DD Palmer, 5 feet, 5 inches, and 162 pounds. So he was a stocky guy, never would have been thought of as slender. His next move back to the context of history, we started with that transatlantic cable. 30 years later, the next big shift in communications was going to be?
Radio.
That's right. And so we know that in the 1890s, we have Tesla demonstrating the first wireless system with Marconi here in New Jersey, demonstrating that distant communication could happen. And while they were doing that, DD Palmer was exploring entirely new questions that was spurred by his vitalistic thinking process. And let me see if I can put this into words that are meaningful to you. And he's saying, he's asking new questions. He wanted to know, why is one person in an environment sick and another person with the same environment healthy? These were questions that were very unusual to the time period. And he's saying, how is it that one guy, is one lucky and the other not? I want to let you listen to BJ speaking about the subject, if I can get this to work.
Wait a minute, where does the mouse come from? Well, it comes from the brain. Wait a minute, why is the mouse getting from the brain to the liver? And there you were stuck. And there he was sent until the Harvey Miller episode. And let me repeat that. Harvey Miller was his grandson. And Harvey Miller was a colored man. Father said to him one day, Harvey, how long have you been deaf? Father said, 17 years. Well, what was the occasion of your going deaf, Harvey? Well, I was in a stoop cramp position, and I heard and felt something pop in my neck. Father said, let me listen to that. Took the hardest of all these cramps and collar and such. Father looked at the neck, and there by one of those miraculous chances of thousand cases, with a great big protuberance of a bump sticking way out. And Father pressed on it. And when he did, Harvey winced with pain. He said, that hurts. Father said, well, now here's the line of thinking. If the production of this bump destroys hearing, the reduction of this bump ought to restore hearing. And so he asked Harvey to lay down on the floor, and for 3 successive days, Harvey could push that bump, and Harvey's hearing was completely restored.
Sorry, the quality of the audio was as weak as it is, but in the 1940s, technology wasn't as far along as it is today. Here's what the office of DD Palmer looked like in 1895. The reason I show you that is one of the interesting parallels. I showed you the picture of Paul Castor before with all the crutches and canes. You'll see, like his mentor, DD liked to get photographed with people who were able to leave those handicap devices behind. There's the Ryan building where DD Palmer's magnetic healing practice occupied the entire top floor of 40 rooms. 40 rooms was a very successful practice. It certainly raised jealousy amongst the ordinary physicians of Davenport to see that man having such extraordinary success. Here's Dee's private office where he was a cutting edge kind of a guy, by the way. Notice in 1895 what he's got sitting on his desk.
What is it? Oh, a phone.
It's a telephone. And he even had electric light. That was cutting edge for the day. At the time of the Harvey Lillard incident, 1890s, DD Palmer would work 5 hours each afternoon. He would see 90 to 100 people a day. That's more than I see, probably more than most of us do. The first adjustment done on Harvey was actually not done on the floor. It was done on an adjusting table. It was done on a wooden table, and if you go to see the archives at Palmer, you can see this table that supported laundry tubs, these galvanized tubs, big things like this big around. And in order to do the adjustment on Harvey Lillard, he had those laundry tubs taken off and he put some kind of cushion on top. And that's the table that the actual adjustment took place on. And kind of interesting to me that that's a significant piece of history. So if you ever get to Davenport, check that out. 3 months after the Harvey Lillard incident, we see the vitalistic philosophy of D.D. Palmer, where he says that magnetism is of man, the highest of creation, healing and life-giving, imparting vital and nerve force. His early explanations continued to hold his spiritualistic flavor as well. He says chiropractic is the name of systematized knowledge and the prolonging of life, making this stage of existence much more efficient in preparation for the life beyond. So he hadn't left that behind. He had this big purpose throughout his experience, and he never did give that up. He always felt like adjusting is not about a backache, people. He never thought it was. My first knowledge of this, however, he gave credit to a channeled spirit, a fellow by the name of Dr. Jim Atkinson, who D.D. contended lived in Davenport about 50 years before. Many people, including myself, have tried to find evidence of a Jim Atkinson outside of D.D. Palmer's own testimony. No one has found a shred of evidence that he actually ever existed yet. Doesn't prove he didn't, but no one has ever found any evidence. And again, he's talking in his text about how the intellectual progress of this world and the next depends upon the proper alignment of the skeletal frame. Slowly and consistently, he grew his business and moved up to the top floor. He used to be in several rooms. I think it was on the second floor originally. This building was still standing when I was a student in Davenport. It doesn't exist any longer. And the bottom floor had a department store in it at that time period in the 1970s. And so back to our chronology, the first adjustment in 1895. The first student who graduated under D.D. Palmer was this fellow 3 years later, a medical doctor, William Seeley, who became a very enthusiastic chiropractor, and so much so that he put his photo on his business card.
I have a question. I heard, and since you're the historian here, that D.D. didn't want to teach anyone this. He wanted to keep it in the family. Is that true?
Correct. The version that B.J. tells about that is that it became a bone of contention between father and son. B.J. saying, you can't adjust all the backbones in the world, and D.D. believing that, no, this thing is worth money, this is worth power, this should be a family secret. D.D. tells it in a little different way in his writing. What he says is that he was involved in a railroad accident where he was nearly killed, and that changed his thinking about it, because B.J. was still a teenager at the time, and he decided, what if I had been killed in that accident? This thing would have died. And so his version is, that convinced me. BJ's version is, he talked his father into it. But there was no doubt that at first he wasn't going to teach him. Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks for the question. And so back to our chronology. In 1902, BJ Palmer graduates, and I've seen BJ's diploma. It was signed by three people, by D.D. Palmer, by BJ Palmer, you're supposed to laugh, and by Mabel Palmer. So, just interesting. How many of you have your own signature on your diploma? And so, here's August Dye, the historian again, talking about the experience of having known D.D. Palmer personally. He cherished the memory, and he said that you would describe this personality as someone who was a rugged individualist. Everything I've seen supports that view. D.D. Palmer was also an inventor, and here's some of the early stationery in a letter from the chiropractic infirmary, which hadn't fully left the area of magnetic healing in the very beginning. But in this particular discussion, in this letter from D.D. Palmer to his son, he's talking about how men who were shipping goldfish were doing it in 2.5 feet of water, which that's a lot of weight, 2.5 feet of water. And he said he realized that you didn't need all the water, you just needed surface area for the fish to get oxygen. So he reduced it to 6 inches of water. And I remember Dave Palmer talking to us in school that day, saying how that's the method still being used today that his grandfather invented back in the around the turn of the century. Here you see BJ in that same picture I showed you a little earlier, talking about the lineage, how father was stubborn and bullish. His combination of Scotch made him thrifty in buying and selling. His Irish made him appreciate a good joke and telling stories. The English and German made him firm in his conviction, or stubborn might be another good word to use. And those things seem to be consistent threads in the personality. In 1902, we find the first time that D.D. Palmer leaves. Now, keep in mind, he discovered chiropractic 7 years before, but here's how BJ explains what happened. He went from a 42-room successful business, and all of a sudden, this guy is leaving town. Now, what happened is he said he knew what he discovered, but that he became boastful and bragging, and instead of taking the transition calmly, he became overbearing in attitude. BJ said that if he passed someone on the street, many people would cross the street not to have to talk to him because he became such a difficult person to get along with. And all of a sudden, we find him going from imminently successful to owing $8,000 in 1902. And again, keep the context, $8,000 in 1902 was big money. So he said to BJ, look, I'm out of here and I'm going to California. When you get a few bucks together, join me and we'll make a killing out there. Now, BJ didn't agree with him on the ethics of the business or on that particular approach. So BJ stayed in Davenport and restored the business. But here's Willard Carver, another important personality of the time period, speaking about that personality. He said, those who knew D.D. Palmer know that no man living could become his associate in business and remain with him for any considerable length of time. Carver was one of the early chiropractors. He was also an attorney, and you'll see later on where he actually started a chiropractic school. Very influential man. That's a picture of his school in Oklahoma City. Timeline again. D.D. Palmer leaves Davenport in 1902. BJ takes over, brings things back, pays off the debts, and turns the school back into a thriving business. And we know that at that time, D.D. was in Pasadena. We know that he wasn't just sitting still. He was practicing chiropractic. He was trying to spread it in the area. We know that he had schools that he tried to start out in California. And we know that he got indicted for the first time, not in Davenport, in California. Here's a picture of D.D. in Santa Barbara at one of the schools that he'd started in 1903. He didn't stay put. He was such an itinerant. Here we find that in 1902, after being indicted, he somehow beat the rap, not because he won in court, he actually did, but the prosecutor decided there was just insufficient evidence to proceed. And so this telegram was sent, and it's in BJ's scrapbook, Cairo found not guilty but he was very excited about beating the rap. And of course, we have evidence of his conducting both a clinic and a school in Santa Barbara. In 1904, now successful again, all debts paid, making a good living, BJ invites DD back and holds the position of president for him. DD returns in 1904, is now president of the school once again. And here's a publication showing that in December 1904, that again, DD is at the reins and he's writing articles in the Chiropractor, which was the journal that the school put out. They had the world's largest collection of spines. In fact, I think Palmer School still claims to have the world's largest collection of abnormal spines. Here's a picture of D.D. Palmer with his matched set of ponies. People in Davenport who knew D.D. back then, who were still alive at the time when the history was being put together, would say it was common to see him driving around town with these very valuable Indian ponies. And you can't see him very well, but that indeed is D.D. driving the ponies there. Their names were Nip and Tuck. I'm going to see if I can just skip one slide because we're slipping behind on our schedule. D.D. did not claim to have invented anything new. It's important to realize that he was very big on integrity and on telling the truth. And so when he had to explain, well, on the one hand, he said, well, I got principles from a spiritual side, from a channeled spirit, if you will. And yet he said, these ideas are not something I came up with. The principles have been around since ancient Egypt and the ancient Greeks. But he said, I did claim to be the first one to replace vertebrae with intention using the spinous and transverse processes with a philosophy behind it. And that's what's different. So he did give credit where credit was due. Here's BJ pointing out that some have suggested that D.D. Palmer stole chiropractic from the Greeks. And he said, that's very misleading. Palmer did give credit. And BJ said, think of the Wright brothers. They didn't do anything new. Birds had been flying for eons of time. But everything they did was new. And so you need to have that perspective, that analogy to understand how new what D.D. Palmer did with his discovery. D.D. said that life is the expression of tone, and he talked about tone repeatedly in his book. He did not view what we do by adjusting vertebrae as restoring electrical signals in the body. He viewed it as restoring tone, meaning the wave motion over nerves, much different than what most people think of today. And yet there's a whole new branch of quantum physics saying, wait a minute, he might have been right in the first place. Here, you know, you asked me a question earlier about how this tyrannical guy could be what he was. Here's another side. Here is Catherine Weed. And you all remember that Samuel Weed named our profession. And Catherine was his daughter, speaking as a grown woman about her memory of receiving chiropractic as well as magnetic care earlier on from D.D. Palmer, who talks about his kind, gentle manner of adjusting. And he didn't charge for taking care of me because I was good and I took the adjustments well. Doesn't sound like a guy tying you and suspending you by your thumbs. So we see many different sides to this personality. And there's a picture of the reception room in D.D. Palmer's office at the time period. Chiropractic's fountainhead, the Palmer School of Chiropractic, one of the early advertisements for students and for the sick. Question?
So who coined the word chiropractor? Samuel Weed.
Reverend Samuel Weed, who was both a patient and a friend, a Greek scholar. We're going to come back to him in a little bit. So in the first half of the presentation, we brought you through an introduction to the life of D.D. Palmer and where he was coming from and what things were influencing him. Now he has created a new profession. So we're going to look at the early years of that profession and how he interacted with it. Solon Langworthy was one of his earliest students. And Solon Langworthy and a couple others, Oakley Smith and Menorah Paxson, were the first ones to ever publish a book on the subject of chiropractic. And that is a copy of the actual text called Modernized Chiropractic. BJ knew that they were writing the book, and BJ was writing his first book. They both were published in 1906. However, Langworthy and his crew beat BJ out by a few weeks and had the honor of being able to claim to have published the first text on chiropractic. This is their school, the American School of Chiropractic. It was located in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, and that was about 80 miles straight west and slightly north of Davenport, and kind of like in the mid part of Iowa, if you will. And they were the first challenge of what you might call the broad scope, or in the word that DD Palmer coined that you probably still know as mixer. And I remember that used to be thought of as a dirty word, and people try not to use it because of its political incorrectness, but it wasn't incorrect to DD Palmer. And the first challenge was this American school. And Langworthy and his cohorts were also very active, just like what I heard in your meeting before we started tonight, where it seems like the other guys are the ones running the board of examiners, and they're the ones doing all the political work. And this was true right from the beginning. And they were the first ones to get a law passed on chiropractic. This was in the state of Minnesota. The legislature passed the law, and when D.D. Palmer found out about it, he was incensed. And so what would you do if you were D.D.? You would go visit the governor of Minnesota and tell him to veto that law, and that's exactly what D.D. did. So the first chiropractic law was not a mixer bill. And it would have changed the complexion of the profession dramatically had they been successful in getting that through. But the struggle continued, of course. And here's what D.D. Palmer thought of, actually, this is not D.D.'s letter, I'm sorry, correction. This is a letter from B.J. to his sister and brother-in-law. And he's talking about what happened during that time period when they were trying to pass that first mixer law. And he said, Dr. Langworthy, that damn fraud is going to try and put a state law through this winter to cut the PSC out, because we will not mix and spoil chiropractic as he has. This was with context to an Iowa law that also failed to go through. We find the mixer challenge goes right back to the earliest days of the profession. In fact, the National School of Chiropractic was opened in 1906, a pivotal year for your profession. And what you may not have noticed is where the National School was founded. By that time, the Palmer School had had so much success, they had outgrown the 42 rooms at the top floor of the Ryan Building downtown, and they had moved up the top of the hill to where not exactly where the campus is now, but most of the way up there, to a much larger facility. So this fellow, Howard, who was one of the early graduates under D.D. Palmer, founded this school in the same building.
Excuse me, I said Howard's system of adjustment. How was that supposed to be different from what BJ and DD were?
You might see it right here, where you'll see the diploma was one of chiropractic and physiological therapeutics. Right from the beginning, it was, wait a minute, it's not just this vertebral subluxation thing. We can do all kinds of stuff to people, and we can do it better than the ordinary physician. And that was their mindset. Sure, they called it chiropractic.
I just wanted to add, when I was in Columbia, they taught Columbia technique.
Right.
Which was partially a system of adjusting the spine, and also a system of massaging the sinuses and milking the gallbladder, all under the guise of being Columbia technique.
Is this how, and I might be moving it, jumping ahead here, but is this how osteopathy broke off, or, you know, and?
No, in actuality, osteopathy never had anything to do with chiropractic, except that it was contrasted to chiropractic in a pivotal law case that we're going to come to in a few minutes.
All right.
I don't want to hold you up on questions, but along that though, I thought that I had read that DD had either studied under or had a relationship with AT Stills.
The reality of that is that he had no no academic relationship with AT Still. There is one documented occasion where both of them met on one occasion, and according to BJ's portrayal of the facts, he says that was the only time in either of their lives they ever met, and it was at a spiritualist convention in Clinton, Iowa. Clinton was about 30 miles north on the Mississippi River, north of Davenport, and both A.T. Still and D.D. Palmer were spiritualists. But while D.D. Palmer read about and studied osteopathy in book form, he was never a student, nor did he ever practice osteopathy. He studied a lot of things. He studied bone setting. He studied anything to do with health, anatomy, physiology, and those were amongst the things at his disposal. It's a good point, though. And so, I'm not sure, was there another question I failed to respond to? So we had this intra-professional politics right from the earliest days. And one of the things that often gets quoted is this statement that's actually showing on a memorial put up in Canada at Port Perry, the hometown of D.D. Palmer. And it says, "I have never felt it beneath my dignity to do anything to relieve human suffering." Now there was an agenda in citing that particular statement from D.D. Palmer. And back in 1950, Dr. Loretta Perkins wrote about how grossly misrepresenting that was to what D.D. Palmer thought and believed. And so what we find is, taken out of context, the purpose was to say, well, D.D. Palmer believed that we should treat all kinds of conditions, that was the role of the chiropractor. And of course, he came from a condition-treating place. As a magnetic healer, he treated sick livers and all kinds of body parts. But when you put this back in context, you find that what he was really saying is that people suffer greatly from bunions and corns, but treating them is not the role of the chiropractor. So when you read the rest of what wasn't quoted, and the actual text reads like this, where he talks about the bunions and corns, and then he says, "It is general opinion among the laity that chiropractors know nothing about corns, bunions, or ingrown toenails, in that they are right." So what was taken out of context was totally reversed in its implication, and that goes on many, many times when you look at what's pulled out of the writings of D.D. Palmer. A curious notion that's contemporary to you and I, in our day, this notion is being circulated. What you'll hear said in our tabloids and in academia, in chiropractic today, is that from the therapeutic-minded folks, they say that the philosophy of chiropractic never was a philosophy. What they're contending instead is that when D.D. Palmer got arrested, a sneaky, smoke-filled room with B.J. Palmer and an attorney came up with this idea that if we build this philosophy, we can win the lawsuit, and we can beat a case. And this had to do with Shigetaro Morikubo's arrest in Wisconsin. But this assertion that the philosophy was never an integral part of chiropractic is what's used today to kind of discredit that philosophy. That was never meant to be part of chiropractic. It was just that crafty BJ and his attorney that came up with it. Well, I did a scholarly piece to try to refute this, and I want to share some of that. But one of the things about it is it's been said so many times that people are starting to believe this is true because they keep repeating it. It reminds me of the trick that Hitler taught us. No matter what you say, be it true or false, if you keep saying it, it becomes the reality. And that's what most in mixerdom believe about your philosophy today, that it really never belonged in chiropractic. And so let's look at the facts. Innate intelligence was one of DD Palmer's earliest conceptions. He said, they were to me a vital fact, a condensed proposition of practical truth, basic principles of the science. That is philosophic talk, not just scientific talk. And so let's look at some more information to document this. I saw fit to date the beginning of chiropractic with the first adjustment, although quite a portion of that which now constitutes chiropractic I had collected during the previous 9 years. Now, Mora Kubo was arrested in 1907. DD is saying that 9 years prior to 1895, he had been collecting this information based on his philosophic principles. He wrote about innate intelligence at least 2 years before Mora Kubo's arrest. Among my writings of 5 years ago was found this one on innate intelligence, which was published in the 1906 book that B.J. Palmer published. And he says in his 1910 text, this volume, I have systematized the knowledge acquired during the last 25 years, both as a spiritualist and a magnetic healer, prior to making that jump into the discovery of chiropractic. Note that he says, together with extensive philosophical explanations of the laws of life. That's 25 years of study that kind of refutes this notion that the philosophy was an afterthought. More evidence. We know that in D.D. Palmer's book, he writes in the beginning, 4 pages of the preface to the book are devoted to his friend W.J. Colville. Colville was a noted spiritualist of the time period, and we know that he talks about his relationship with Colville as an old friend. And we know that Colville's thinking, when you study where he was coming from, is strongly linked to transcendental philosophy. So it's very easy to start to build a case for the philosophic underpinnings that D.D. Palmer was building this chiropractic upon. Then we go to Emanuel Swedenborg, whose doctrine of correspondences is referenced in Colville's book, Ancient Mysteries and Modern Revelations. And the major element of Colville's thinking was an influence at the time of D.D. Palmer's formulation of his ideas that were being sculpted by people with whom he associated with, who were influenced by transcendental thinking. So this has its roots deeply in philosophy. Swedenborg's influence on the transcendentalist is very well established in lots of scholarly writing, especially in the case of Ralph Waldo Emerson, who was one of the people that D.D. Palmer read. And in a contemporary book written by Simon Senzon, who's he's got his master's in philosophy, he's also a chiropractor, and he talks about the traveling library of D.D. Palmer, the one that he took on the road when he went to California and all of that. And he talks about how D.D. was thinking philosophically back in those time periods in 1902 and before. This is how Senzon describes Palmer's philosophy. He's taking a stand against the mistaken identity of Descartes and Locke while he was marrying Plotinus and Fichte with Spinoza. I mean, that's not an afterthought that B.J. came up with to defend Mora Kubo. And so I wanted to check on the veracity of this traveling library, so I contacted friends at Palmer and I asked them about this traveling library. Do you really have it there? And do you have documentation that it really belonged to D.D. Palmer when he was on the road? And so I got this response, and Alana, who is still at the college, said that she and Glenda, who was the archivist at the time, spent about a week going through the mansion looking for anything D.D., and the only thing they could find in the way of textual material was this particular bound edition. And he says several books that were bound together, and amongst those we find D.D.'s signature saying, this is my book inside, one dated 1873, another dated 1876. They could identify the fact that these were D.D.'s books. They could not verify that he took them on the road to California, but that sort of hardly matters the way I view it. You can document that this was the philosophic waters that D.D. was swimming in. Moving on. I systematized these principles and made them practical. I created and brought into existence and originated a science which I named chiropractic. Therefore, I am a scientist. I have reasoned from cause to effect. Answered the question. He believed this, Joe. What is life? He believed he answered that question. And when you read D.D., you can see that it's plausible that he did. And founded a science and philosophy upon the basic principle of tone. This knowledge I've given to the world, therefore I am a philosopher. This was D.D.'s own point of view. D.D. defined innate intelligence. That which I named innate, born with, is a segment of that intelligence which fills the universe. D.D. Palmer was definitely not a mechanist. He said that the science of chiropractic and machinery have nothing in common, and he goes on to talk about not thinking of man like a machine because it makes no sense to evaluate it that way. He was what we call a vitalist. And so we look at some of his writing on vitalism, we find D.D. saying animal magnetism, now this is 3 months after Harvey got adjusted. Animal magnetism and machine electricity are two very different forces. Magnetism is of man, meaning animal magnetism, that stuff Mesmer was talking about. The highest of creation, life-giving force. Note, Palmer's writing on a philosophic doctrine at that time period, 10 years prior to the arrest of Morikubo. If you need more documentation, I can get it. The universe is composed of the invisible and the visible. If there's anything D.D. would have said he brought to the world that was new, he would have said, and he did say, he united the immaterial world and the material world and brought them together. He said that the universe is composed of the visible and the invisible. Life is but the expression of spirit through matter. To make life manifest requires the union of spirit and body. He claimed to have done this, to bring the two together. By the way, do you all know why that picture's on there?
That's Reggie Gold's. That was on his property for a while.
That's right. Reggie, when he sold his house, he donated that and we put it in a museum for him.
Cool.
But did you know that that raptor was made by the same sculptor that did the work in Jurassic Park?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And BJ paid the guy $10,000. Reggie paid $10,000 to make that sculpture. The chiropractor looks upon the body as more than a machine, the union of conscious and unconscious. That's that material and immaterial. And so that's what D.D. felt he had really done, that no one else had really done well, because for a couple of hundred years, scientists had been dividing the body into the mechanical, away from the immaterial. There was a paradigm shift that took place in D.D. Palmer's thinking, and he said that chiropractic is not a system of therapeutics. It does not use remedies. Now remember, why is this a paradigm shift? Because D.D. Palmer was treating diseases. He was a magnetic healer. He was taking the crutches away from the cripple. And now all of a sudden he said, wait a minute, we're not therapeutists at all. We're something else. So this was a major shift. D.D. Palmer's shift, there's no line of education that is so permeated with superstition as that of curing diseases. The words cure and heal, so guarded by medical men, are of superstition. The words of D.D. Palmer. So he became enlightened. A few years back, B.J. Palmer's scrapbook on chiropractic was rediscovered. It was 30 feet tall. It was in an elevator shaft. 30 feet tall, all kinds of documents. And one of the documents was this letter written by Reverend Samuel Weed, the guy who named chiropractic. And when D.D. Palmer wanted to find a name to describe what he did, he wanted to honor the Greeks because they were engaged in these principles of healing. And so he said to his friend Reverend Weed, the Greek scholar, find me words that I can name this new profession by. This letter was sent by Samuel Weed to D.D. Palmer with a lot of options. Here's some things to think about to choose the name chiropractic. And so I'll expand that a little bit for you to see. Amongst the choices was the word chiro or chirizo. And that meant surgical work done by hand. Can you see how that really didn't fit?
Right.
Okay. And so then we find curist or chirotherapeutist, which meant curing or nursing with medicines. And here's Samuel Weed's handwriting, therapeutist, curing or nursing. And so that was also rejected, as you can see, because it just really didn't fit, even though it came from the Greek. And then D.D. was thinking about moving away from words like physician and healing, and so the word curatrice and curiatric, even though you hear people try to say chiropractrics and such, that meant hand physician or hand healer. He was trying to get away from therapy, and healing and physician were inappropriate words. And so we find Samuel Weed, that's his picture there. And BJ said, oh, by the way, the whole Weed family were a bunch of weeds. There wasn't one of them, male or female, less than 6 foot tall. But the Reverend said, the best word I could come up with was chirocatartist, one who adjusts or puts right by hands. He also suggested chiropraxic, curatry, and then, of course, finally, chiropractic. And you can see in his handwriting, he liked chirocatartist, but he said it's kind of a jawbreaker. So you almost ended up, I don't like the sound chiropractic. I would not have liked chirocatartist any better. But you can see D.D.'s thinking evolve as he was moving away from that therapeutic model. And then, of course, here's the word chiropractic in the letter from Samuel Weed. The non-therapeutic model continues to evolve, and we see D.D. here saying that all therapeutic methods, including osteopathy, treat effects. Chiropractors do not treat, they fix. They adjust, they repair. Bob, didn't you say that something with a radio dial?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. They put things right, they restore, they do anything but treat, manipulate, or operate. And so this is going back to 1890s that this was his evolving thought period. D.D. Palmer, this discoverer, scholar, founder, teacher, student of chiropractic, wrote only one book during his lifetime that he published on chiropractic. And in the front of the first copy of the first edition, he signed it to his son, B.J. Palmer, my only son, number one of the first issue of the first book ever published on the science, art, and philosophy of chiropractic by the founder. Earlier on, and you'll see an engraving that his son gave him where he wrote, here's the first book ever published on chiropractic. Mm-hmm. And so this was one, there's that engraving from, he said, with kindest regards, I present you with number one of the first issue of the first book ever published on chiropractic. Of course, BJ had he painted with a wide brush sometimes, and the fact of the matter that he had been beaten to publication by a few weeks wasn't mentioned in this engraving. But he did present his father with the very first book, which his father opposed. He did not want him publishing at that time. He felt like he hurried up too much to do good quality work. Here's a picture of D.D. and some of the early students. There's Mabel, B.J., and of course D.D. In 1906, the medical attacks began in earnest. And we see a telegram to Willard Carver. You'll remember Willard Carver was a family friend, chiropractor, and attorney. And of course it says, father's in jail, come to Davenport at once. They wanted counsel from a trusted family friend and attorney. And so we know that there was a lot of rivalry between DD and other physicians of Davenport for many years, both in his magnetic days and in his chiropractic days. And so there was, finally it came to the arrest, and we know that he went to court, he lost the lawsuit. And here's from a newspaper clipping showing a little bit of the philosophy. This is an interview that took place in the jail cell where DD Palmer, he said, after I went to jail, several people's phoned to my home and asked if they would be able to send money that I could pay my bail. And he said, I am not in a cell for lack of principle, but for an abundance of principle. The man had a way with words, I would say. And here he's writing in a letter to Solon Langworthy, the beginnings of mixing, and he's writing to him saying, I'm in jail, it's 10 a.m., I'll have 4 days now. I don't know if I've ever been happier in my life. I've got breakfast was good bread, poor coffee, poor molasses. He talked about how the cell was filthy. He cleaned it himself, and he's got everything nice. And then he said, my rent is paid for 3.5 months, which includes water, steam, heat, and a janitor. I'm pleased that it has been my lot, this from the same letter, to be incarcerated for the science which I've devoted so many years to develop. I remain, as ever, the discoverer and developer of chiropractic, and I am ready to stand by it. We know that this was a pivotal moment in his life as well, because everything changed after this time period. We talked to you a little bit about the arrest the next year of Shigetaro Morikubo, the Japanese scholar, and we know that his was the very first victory in court for the chiropractic profession a year after D.D. Palmer was jailed. Here's a rare photo, it's the only one I've ever seen, of D.D. Palmer doing an adjustment. It's a picture, a little close-up of his hands. The man on the table is Shigetaro Morikubo. So it's kind of an important picture, both for its rarity and for who's in it. I ran into somebody who was important in the history of chiropractic, so the second time I had a chance to write a scholarly article and get published about D.D. Palmer's life took place because of this guy that I met. Juanita Whitlock was a longtime member of my practice in Iowa, and one day, a couple years after her husband passed away, but Martin P. Brown was a medical doctor. Not only did he become a chiropractor, but he was graduate number 6 under D.D. Palmer. So he came along right at the very beginning of the teaching of chiropractic. And when Carver came to give advice to the Palmer family about what to do now that D.D. has been arrested, he said, well, the first thing I want you to do is take all your assets from both you and B.J. and get them out of your name. So they put all of the buildings and everything in the name of Mabel Palmer. And then the next piece of advice was hire a physician who's a member of the American Medical Association to run the business, because they're going to have a much harder time gathering new evidence and attacking you if it's one of their own doing the publishing. So they had this recent graduate, M.P. Brown, who was now practicing as an M.D., D.C., and they got him to come back, and he took over running the school. So it turns out this blowhard was really telling the truth. It also turned out that Delos, after a couple of months, I think it was about 6 months or so, became a patient in our practice as well, which we call practice members, not patients. But at that time, we still called them patients. And he became very interested. And then one day, he said, by the way, I've still got grandfather's adjusting table in the attic. Yeah. And I thought, you have what? And I said, well, listen, whatever you do, protect that thing. I'd like say, don't destroy it, I'll buy it from you. But that's an important artifact for our profession. No, I don't want to sell it, and I don't want to go up in the attic. And so for a couple of years, this went on. I'd ask about the table. Then one day, he shows up in my office with this elegant two-piece oak adjusting table, which folds up into a suitcase size. That was one of the very earliest, made in the early 1900s, of portable adjusting tables. Shows up with it, and I said, well, how much you want for it? And he gave it to me. He wouldn't take a penny. And later on, I donated it to a museum. On the underside, you can see written in M.P. Brown's handwriting on a piece of glued-on paper, 828 Brady Street, which was the address of the school before it moved to its current site, which is 1000 Brady Street. This guy was so important in the history of our profession that in one of BJ's books, he talks about the cafeteria inside the administration building and downstairs from there. And he said on the tops of the supporting columns, which I can remember very well, are engraved the names of faculty members of the dear old PSC in order as they took unto themselves our burdens of carrying the chiropractic load. First one, DD. Second column, BJ. Third column, Mabel H. Fourth column, Martin P. Brown. And so he was important, yet nobody knew who he was. So the title of my article in the publication was Overlooked. And then we talked about him. Now, we know that jail had an impact on DD Palmer. We know that his leadership of the profession ended at that point in time. We don't know why, but we've read some conjectures about why. But we do know that his life changed dramatically. He became suspicious, he became unhappy, he was very critical of BJ and everyone else in the profession at that time, and he became even somewhat despondent. After he came out of jail, he left Davenport, went on the road, and remained an itinerant for the rest of his life. He went to many different places, started many failed business relationships, several different chiropractic schools, and had a fairly unhappy time from that period forward. August Dye, the elder historian who wrote his book in the 1930s and knew DD personally, talked about it but didn't give any explanation for why. Maynard, who wrote a more recent book, Healing Hands,
right,
talked about it, and he didn't provide documentation, but he says that it was rumored that in his exercise in the jail cell, he would do an exercise that he invented himself. There were concrete block walls, and so he had all these concrete block lines, and his exercise was to reach up and see how high he could jump to exercise and stretch. And what Maynard said he thinks happened was that he fell over on his head on the concrete floor of the jail, causing illness. He also conjectured that maybe that was why he paid his fine after 23 days instead of staying in, that he was ill. But there's no good evidence to support that other than that one source, so I don't offer it as fact, just we don't know why, but we know he became very erratic in his personality, much more so after the jail experience. But maybe something will be turned up later on. And so we see his writing. He referred to, in one of his letters to his son BJ, he refers to two people that he called the snake and the goose. The snake was BJ's mother-in-law. The goose was his wife, Mabel. And you'll notice, of course, that BJ claimed to have had the first horseless carriage west of the Mississippi River. And when he was taking it for a drive, he put his mother-in-law in the safest seat. But DD was very bitter. He said that the two of them had poisoned DD's mind, that somehow that they were saying, well, BJ's running the school into the ground, he's doing things for his own self-aggrandizement, he's not doing it the way you would want it to be done. And so they're saying, that these were the problem. Right? Okay.
BJ was the problem?
No, that the women were.
Oh, yeah.
And especially so Dee Dee's wife, Molly, who is not in this picture. And he had actually been married 5 times. And his 5th wife was saying, you need to get out of jail. BJ's doing things that are different than the way you'd want it done. And so you had these people and those people. And it just, in Dee Dee's mind, which is now, I'm sitting in a jail cell. I'm not feeling well. I'm no longer in charge. He thought of himself as the leader, as the founder, and now he's nothing. He's sitting in a jail. So that's what we see. The evidence is sketchy. When the book was written, against his wishes, he said to BJ, DD said, how much better to have had those chiropractic books grammatically written? The extra expenses would have been light, but old dad, meaning himself, was not there to do it. So he felt angry toward BJ, and he sold his interest in the school to BJ when he left town, but he said, oh, you stole everything from me. And so here's something he wrote to BJ. Well, I was helpless in prison. You usurped all. You left me penniless. In settlement, you took every advantage. BJ said, come back and be the president. And he said, there's no great honor in doing that anymore. And he refused. Yes.
I have a quick question. Well, actually, one's a statement. First of all, I know you made reference earlier on to Keating, and I think that guy is one of the biggest poisoners of chiropractic history I've ever read before. But aside from that, that was a comment. The other thing was, what happened to, there was a whole thing with BJ and the father, and supposedly he apparently attempted to run him over.
We're going to cover that later.
Oh, okay.
And I'm sorry, this is taking a while, but
okay.
I do want to share that with you in a little bit.
Okay.
But yes, it's fascinating. Here is an actual document from the binding arbitrations to demonstrate that BJ did not steal anything when DD sold his interest. He received $2,196.79, which was what a committee of friends that were from both sides got together. They argued for a couple of days and came up with, this is the deal. Here's how much you get. Here's how much BJ keeps. And so there was a legal settlement, and that's also very well documented. The thing about the running you over and all that, will come to that.
Okay.
We know that DD was jealous of the great success BJ was enjoying at the time period, and others were enjoying, while everything that DD took on after he left Davenport seemed to be unsuccessful. And so we know that he was bitter. He said many nasty things about his son in writing and verbally. He returned to Davenport again in 1911 and 1912. They tried to reconcile between father and son. We know that there was a rival school, the Universal College, in Davenport, Iowa. And DD would come to town and he'd visit, but he would also lecture at the rival school, just to kind of needle his son a little bit, I guess. And so here's your timeline again. 1906, he gets jailed. Soon after he gets out of jail, he leaves right away, never goes back to work at the school again. He sells his interest to DD. He goes to Oklahoma City next, and then ends up on the West Coast later. And then 4 years later, we see him in Portland, Oregon, and he has published his first and only textbook that he published up there in Portland in 1910. But when he went to Oklahoma City, he got in partnership with this medical doctor, Gregory, and they started the Alva Gregory, the Palmer Gregory School of Chiropractic. It didn't last very long, but the relationship lasted only a few months. And it's said that DD just couldn't get along with anybody, and that seemed to have been the case. Here's Frank Elliott, a family friend, a cousin of Mabel Palmer, and a longtime employee of the Palmer School of Chiropractic, saying DD was very peculiar. He was so argumentative that he irritated everyone. At times he was very much affable, but one only had to express an opinion, and the war was on. And that was what everybody just keep, that theme keeps showing up over and over. Here's a very rare photo of the Palmer family at dinner. Here's BJ, son Dave, Mabel. Molly was the fifth and final wife of DD. This would have been right around the time period when he was arrested. And then Portland, Oregon, old dad Chiro founded the DD Palmer College of Chiropractic there, and that's where he published his book. The Chiropractor Adjuster was actually a periodical that he did a lot of compiling. So when he wrote his text, it reads, how many of you have actually read that book? I mean, sat down and read it. If anyone had read their hand, I raised their hand, I would say, you're lying. Nobody reads that book. I mean, I've read the book, but I could never sit down and read the book. It's not an easy read. It jumps all over the place. It has lots of references to personalities and things that, without a lot of context, you would struggle with. It's a very difficult 1,000-page read. It's more than 1,000, about 1,100 pages. But be that as it may, it's a valuable text, and I recommend you look up things that you're interested in the text if you really want to get a sense of who DD was. And here is a diploma from that school, the DD Palmer College of Chiropractic in Portland, Oregon. Here's the year 1907. Portland, Oregon, there are some of the students. In fact, of all the schools that DD started besides the dear old PSC in Davenport, this is the only one that survives, and today it's the Western States University. Now, kind of the furthest extreme on the broad scope, condition-centered model of chiropractic, but yet it was founded by DD and with Leroy Gordon, who was his partner. And like all of his other relationships, DD didn't stay very long. I think it was like 3 or 4 years, and then he was moved back to California. And then when he moved to California, we know in the area of time, 1910, 1911, he was teaching in Southern California at the Routledge School. That's Dr. Routledge. And that school later became the Cleveland Chiropractic College in LA, which only closed a couple of years ago, 3 or 4 years ago, wasn't it? But I mean, it was a mainstream school, and they had lineage right back to D.D. Palmer. An interesting thing that you were alluding to before, Tony, was that, Tony, right?
Right.
Yeah. Was that there was this other institution in Davenport, and one of the first times that there was a major insurrection at the Palmer School was when BJ brought x-ray into the profession in 1910. The first spinal x-rays ever taken were actually taken at the Palmer School in Davenport, Iowa. X-ray was invented in 1895, or discovered, and before there were machines, a number of years passed. And so the first time anybody actually had equipment and started learning how to do this on the spine was when BJ bought an x-ray machine in 1910. But there was this concept that chiropractic is with hands only. And some of the philosophically minded faculty said, BJ, you can't do that. You're betraying your principles. And so BJ's handpicked philosophy teacher, this guy, Joy Loban, organized an insurrection. And one day, while BJ is lecturing to the whole school, they all get up, 50% of the student body and half the faculty, get up in the middle of the lecture and march out on BJ. They march down to the bottom of Brady Street Hill, where they had rented a building and opened the Universal School in protest. When DD would come to town, he would teach at the Universal School. After the death of DD Palmer in 1913, there were a number of rivals that hated BJ and everything he stood for, and they and Loban got together with this accusation that BJ had killed his father by running him over at the Lyceum Parade. It was an insane accusation. It's been investigated thoroughly by a number of historians, as well as BJ himself. BJ wrote a whole textbook on the subject, and the title of that textbook was With Malice Aforethought. And it just goes on. It's tedious to go through because there's so much documentation available. But what happened, of course, was that they claimed that these injuries caused DD's death 3 months later. He went back to California, and he became ill soon after that. The grand jury in Davenport met three different times because there was a lot of pressure to indict BJ for the murder of his father. And after investigation revealed that Loban's affidavits were false, it was the retraction or the recanting of the affidavits that caused the grand jury not only to throw it out, but there were threats made that if he didn't recant, he was going to be arrested and prosecuted. So as it turns out, it was nonsense. But nevertheless, it haunted BJ till his death. People would come up with this thing and say, is it true that you killed your father? You know, stuff like that. This is that infamous parade where this was supposed to have happened, the only picture ever taken of the first Lyceum parade. The reason given, by the way, was that there was a car that BJ was riding in, and they had a seat in another car for DD. And he was so upset that he didn't want to be in a car. He said, I'm supposed to be out here leading the parade. I'm the fountainhead of chiropractic. So he kept on jumping out in front of the parade, and the police had to lead him off repeatedly until they finally grabbed him by the scruff of the neck and sat him down on the curb. But that's what the eyewitnesses said happened. Here's his actual death certificate. You can see he died of typhoid fever in 1913.
How old was
it? 68, I believe, is correct. I'd have to redo the math.
45, 68.
I believe it's 68. 45 to 13?
It's 15.
Good math.
70.
It's one of my strong suits.
Yeah. And so this picture is the only photo of the three generations taken together. It was actually taken by that guy, Frank Elliott, you saw earlier. And that was while DD was staying at BJ's house in the mansion, and he promised to behave himself if he stayed there. And so they were getting along pretty well until the parade, and then, of course, things got a little crazy. DD described the science of chiropractic. It includes the art of adjusting vertebrae and the reason for doing it. He was a specific thinker. We think in terms of specificity as being BJ's big thing, but actually it goes back to DD. And that was what made him different from other magnetic healers, and it's what led him on his quest to do something different. He wanted to be efficient. He wanted to do one thing when others were doing many things. And he said, chiropractic is a science just so far as it is specific. The ability to discriminate and be precise is what makes chiropractic both a science and an art. And he was a specific thinker as a magnetic healer. He said, I wanted to know what made one person sick and one person healthy. He was also known to put his magnetic healing only into the affected part instead of the entire body. In my practice for 10 years under which I named magnetic, I treated nerves, followed and relieved them of inflammation. I was fully aware that I was just treating effects. It took years to discover and develop chiropractic. He said, the osteopath manipulates, the chiropractor does not. The osteopath uses many movements, which are manipulation. The latter does his work by one movement. I referred to the chiropractor who is specific, who adjusts one vertebra with a special purpose. A chiropractor who adjusts all up and down the spine is a manipulator. He said, they're no better than an osteopath. Now, he was a full spine chiropractor, so don't confuse this with BJ's HIO. But we think in terms of this high level of specificity of one vertebra. Well, it sounds like Gonstead, or it sounds like BJ, but it really stems from DD Palmer. Chiropractors should be specific, making one simple movement in the spine at a particular spot in the right direction. He would berate chiropractors of the day who typically adjusted a minimum of 6 to 12 segments on every visit. That's a lot of forces going through a person's spine. He said, I'm pleased to state that chiropractors have outgrown it of no further use for medicine, magnetics, vibrators, or osteopathy. They practice chiropractic unmixed. Why not take another step forward and only be specific? DD Palmer said, a chiropractor who comprehends these principles and uses this science will have no use for adjuncts. In proportion as he lacks that understanding and knowledge and confidence, and the two go together, he will use remedies and become a mixer. That was DD's word. The more he mixes, the less use he has for chiropractic. His viewpoint on mixing, here's an early letter from DD Palmer, his signature at the bottom. He's talking about that first book where Langworthy beat BJ to publication. Here he's sending a letter to DD, or rather to his son BJ, talking about what he thought of modernized chiropractic. First text published is Orthopedic Surgery, traceable back to Hippocrates, BC 460. Here's a good example of DD Palmer's wit and humor. He says, is it possible that Langworthy has just awakened from a trance of 2,360 years? So his viewpoint on mixing, he was very definite. And he also criticized his son. He said, you once tried to drag nature cures into the science, and I finally drew you back into line. I have not thrown any obstacles in your way. I'd be pleased to know that when I had left the science of chiropractic in the hands of one or more who keep it in such a manner that I may return in spirit form and not be ashamed of it. So he was highly, highly critical of his son at the same time that he showed much affection to him. So much contrast. And his viewpoint on mixing? Chiropractic is so vastly different, such a chasm between it and other methods, that those who do not fully imbibe its principles will be inclined to mix it with others, thereby making a conglomeration which Joe D. finds disgusting. Right? Yes, he's agreeing with me. That's the first time in 10 years you've agreed with me. Just kidding. DD was always critical of the practices and teaching of those from who he felt strayed, from the straight and narrow. That's historian August Dye. Back to your context of time, Langworthy offered partnership in 1902, which DD turned down. He rejected another offer of partnership with Carver, who became a mixer, in 1905. In 1905, he also visited the governor of Minnesota to get that law vetoed. And so he was an activist in every way. Had he been living in New Jersey at this time, he'd be a member of the Garden State. D.D. Palmer's viewpoint on himself, every important chiropractic idea that I've advanced has been bitterly assailed. I've been discouraged at times, but I have not turned from that which I knew was correct. His own self-image. How did he define chiropractic? Only twice in all his writing did he define chiropractic. This one we had engraved in stone. Chiropractic is a name I originated to designate the science and art of adjusting vertebrae. It does not relate to the study of etiology or any branch of medicine. Chiropractic includes the science and art of adjusting vertebrae, the know-how and the doing. Page 225 of his text. And that important character, Mark Hugo, said, like the horizon, chiropractic shows limitation only when you are incapable of seeing further. At the point where you thought the heaven touched the earth is where it vanishes. And let me conclude with BJ talking to you about his father. I think I can make this work.
Well, anyhow, it's interesting to close with this one thought. When father was out in Letts, he met a Molly Hudler, and he dearly loved that woman. I don't know why he didn't marry her. Perhaps he was then married to one of his wives. I don't know. But he He fell desperately in love with Molly Huddler. And he didn't see her for many, many years. And finally, one year, he came back. And when he was a widow, Villa Thomas, who was the fifth wife, had died. And he was now single. And he ran into Molly Huddler and married her finally at the end, the sixth wife. And Molly was a pretty decent sort of a gal. I liked her. And I think she liked us. We kids. But I just mentioned the passing to show you that if at first you don't succeed, keep sucking till you do. And so Father married his first love, Lass. I don't want you to get the wrong impression. Peculiarly, I have very little respect for my father as a father. Now, don't misconstrue that. As a father, he never was a father to weak children. But I place that man up on a pedestal. To me, he is one of the great men of history.
And so that's how I'd like to conclude this discussion. If you're looking for more information, I've got my email address there. Publication, you can find in your notes, I believe, the links to looking at some of the materials we've got published on the subject. And in about another week, when the profession celebrates its anniversary, you'll be able to go online and get the latest new book on DD Palmer's life. And let me know if you need any help finding that. Thank you for listening.